Computers look nothing like they used to. I mean, we've all seen that 1966 episode of I Dream of Jeannie where Tony sneaks into NASA's computer room to calculate when Jeannie's birthday is. What do you mean my experiences aren't universal? We've all seen the movie Hidden Figures, where in 1961, Octavia Spencer's character learns how to... Still no, really? Computers used to be the size of rooms. That's all I'm trying to say. But even before that, like the early 1800s, they used to be the size of looms. Because that's when a French weaver named Joseph-Marie Jacquard was searching for a better way to make fabric. And although he didn't realize it when he invented the Jacquard loom, what he had created was the inspiration for the first proper computer. Before we can get to punch cards, we have to pull a Huey Lewis in the news and go back in time. Back to before we could even turn a computer on, because electricity wasn't a thing. And if we really want to understand pre-electric computers, we have to broaden our definition of the word computer a little bit. Now, technically the word computer was used to refer to the humans doing the computations, but we're going to stick to the tools that people used to perform those computations. And when you break things down to the fundamentals, every computational tool shares four features. A physical structure, a way to represent the various elements in a particular problem, a way to change that structure to actually solve a problem, and finally, a way to determine the order that you make those changes, in other words, the order of operations. I've basically just described a calculator, and humans have been using those to solve problems for more than 2,000 years. Behold, the abacus! It doesn't look anything like the Apple IIs you had in your elementary school computer lab, but it does let you compute things when the power goes out. And the abacus was just the beginning, of course. For example, in 1642, the French polymath Blaise Pascal invented a machine that could carry numbers. He was only 18 at the time, and it was to help his father with his job, which makes me feel doubly unaccomplished. Then in the 1800s, Charles Babbage became the so-called father of modern computing. In 1837, he designed the analytical engine. It was meant to be a follow-up to his difference engine calculator, and it would have been the first general-purpose computer, except for the fact that it was so complicated it was never actually built. But in between those two events, the history of computer science takes a very weird detour through a textile factory. But all science needs funding, so first, an ad. This SciShow video is supported by SciShow's favorite band, Eclipsis. This band is so good that the only word you can use to describe them is unreal. If you didn't hear their music last April on the Path of Totality tour, well, they're back at it this year to celebrate the upcoming total lunar eclipse on March 14th. While no one is quite sure when or if Eclipsis's new album will be released for the general public, SciShow is 100% behind them and showing our appreciation for them and for the upcoming lunar eclipse by rocking this brand new limited edition shirt. It celebrates their newly announced upcoming album, Blood Moon, with the tracklist on the back including song titles that bear a striking resemblance to some SciShow video titles. You can find a playlist of those tracklist videos down in the description and a shirt of your own at complexly.store/bloodmoon. Now, I learned my lesson from the beginning of this episode that my knowledge set is not universal, so let's review the very basics about how weaving works. Every woven fabric has a warp, which is the vertical threads, and weft, which is the horizontal threads. And to make a bolt of fabric on a loom, you pass a weft thread back and forth through the warp threads. But if you also want a fancy pattern, you have to strategically raise and lower the various warp threads each time around. Joseph-Marie Jacquard was a weaver and merchant by trade, and back in his day, better known as the late 1700s/early 1800s, this whole process was done by a master weaver and a child called a draw boy. Yes, this story does involve child labor. The weaver would control the overall process and pass the weft threads back and forth. Meanwhile, the draw boy would raise and lower the warp threads as needed for the design. And it worked, but all this manual labor made patterned fabrics very expensive. Plus, raising and lowering all those threads by hand was very slow. So Jacquard thought there might be a way to get it done faster and more efficiently. And after years of work, he invented the Jacquard loom. The Jacquard loom changed everything, because it basically allowed the weaver to raise and lower the warp as needed without the need for a draw boy, which of course did not solve the problem of child labor, but that's not a problem for this video. But what does this have to do with computers? It's how Jacquard figured out how to get his machine to produce a specific pattern, a rotating carousel of punch cards. First, a designer would, well, design the pattern on a gridded paper. That paper was then given to another person who'd actually punch out the appropriate spaces on the punch cards. Each punch card represented the instruction for a given line in the design. A punch told the machine to lift a specific thread, and no punch meant leave it be. Basically, each warp thread was attached to a separate metal hook, and wherever the punch card had a hole in it, that hook was aligned so it could catch onto a long bit of metal that would raise both the hook and its corresponding warp thread. But if there was no hole in a space, that hook got shifted a little bit so it couldn't catch the metal and the warp thread would stay where it was. The loom was also built so that as soon as you were done making one line in your pattern, the carousel would automatically rotate to the next card, so you could rinse and repeat, easy peasy. Now, if the function of those cards sounds familiar to you, that's because it's basically binary code, a punch for one and no punch for zero, which is the foundational language for all modern computing. And both Charles Babbage and Ada Lovelace, who's often referred to as the first computer programmer, realized these punch cards were an amazing way to convey information from a human to a machine. In fact, Babbage admired Jacquard's work so much that he had a portrait of him in his house that wasn't painted, but made on a Jacquard loom. And when it was time for him to develop his analytical engine, he built it around the inputting of punch cards to automatically convey information to the machine and command it to complete its calculations. First, you'd feed a card into the machine and it would get pressed up to a series of levers. Those levers would then draw the mechanical components into line for the desired operation. If a hole was present, the associated lever would go through. If not, the lever would just bump up against the card. When a lever passed through a hole, it would lift a gear into place, causing the machine to proceed with its work. You can certainly see the similarities. Now, the analytical engine was never fully built, and human civilization pretty much hit pause on computer science for more than a century. But the idea of punch cards persisted and were eventually used to store a wide variety of information, not just fabric patterns and computer code. For example, the US government used punch cards to record data for the 1890 census. And they were so useful for computation and programming that they didn't even vanish after modern electrical computers came onto the scene. Seriously, the script editor of this episode asked her mom if she used punch cards in college in the early 80s, and she said yes, and heaven help you if you got them out of order. But obviously, since electronics were involved, the card reading process was a little bit different. Each card represented a single line of binary code. It was fed into a reader, which would scan the cards and turn the strategically punched holes into ones and zeros. Same old, although those early readers used electrically conductive brushes, which either completed an electric circuit when there was no hole, or broke the circuit when there was a hole. And slightly more modern scanners worked a bit like modern copy machines, where the one or zero was based on how much light got reflected. We're only a few decades removed from punch cards, and that's wild considering I can fit a computer way more powerful than anything NASA had in the 1960s into my pocket. But we wouldn't have gotten there the way we did without an ambitious tailor. So thanks, Jacquard, for indirectly inspiring one very specific sitcom plot that nobody in our audience has seen.